industry and innovation, we're finally moving into something that we would find to be very familiar to us and something that we would also find to be very interest sparking. I will be perfectly honest, I have way too much material for tonight. There's just no way to break this down into anything smaller. So I'm going to plow through as much as I possibly can. Please take my slides and review them afterwards if you want to, because it's going to be a ton. First off, what happened in this time frame? And let's go into it. So what happened in this time frame? So we're looking at number one, America is a key player in sacred music development through hymnals. And we are going to talk about hymnals tonight. Number two, we are looking at it being used, these lovely hymnals are still also part of the groundwork that was laid centuries earlier with singing schools, which end up promoting music education in public schools as well. We see that a wide new variety of hymns are added to our rich tradition that we have here in this country. A lot of those hymns cross over from Catholic to Protestant back and forth. There are actually a couple that I found that have crossed over from Protestant to LDS. So there's even a crossover happening there with the same hymns. Texts are usually adapted just a little bit, but you still see some of that movement happening. If we're looking at it from a big picture, we're looking at the Industrial Revolution. It gives birth to the middle class as we know it, as a permanent fixture in our social structure. Middle class has been around for a while, does not necessarily mean that it has been a permanent part of our structure, though. The music starts to be more catered to their interests, and their interests are very specific. They're not as geared towards the wealthy interests. They have their own tastes. And so now we're seeing that composers are working for them as well. Composers are bucking the patron system, and they are working in a more independent format. This is giving rise to innovations and advancements in a rapid style. They can now choose what they want to do on their own, which is why you get composers that sound so very different from each other during this time frame. And you start to see that the orchestra is going to expand new instruments, and some of which may actually surprise us today were being prevalent in their use earlier than we would think, and as early as this time frame. And I'm speaking of the saxophone, actually. So let's go on to the next slide. Why does this matter? It matters because the middle class is where modern Americana Christianity happens primarily, even today. It happens in low class and it happens in the middle class. Once we have the middle class, we have this new large group of people that want music in their worship setting, and they are able to form churches in which they are able to contribute funds to make sure that it is happening. Music is going to be facing a lot of changes, and just like the general industry of the time, it's going to be facing a lot of changes that allow it to become more accessible to a lot of different people. I say this is the birth of the experience, which you and I know. This is the time frame where we're going to be sitting in a mass, holding a hymnal, having an experience similar to what we know today. That is starting to happen now. And so that is what we are looking at tonight. Let's go on to the next slide. Part one, industry and expansion of taste. Next slide. So the elements that we're talking about tonight in this chunk, we are industrialized now, and we're looking at the Industrial Revolution. We're looking at the rise of the middle class, music in the home, music as concert, a piano, expression of emotion, masses and choral spectacle, working class taste becoming gentrified, and rural to urban. Let's break all of that down. First off, the Industrial Revolution. We have the rise of the machine age. Never before did we see anything like this, where suddenly we had a massive new industry. We have a massive new way of life that is coming into our thought process. It changes everything about life. The concept of the factory now means things can be mass produced. Before, if you wanted to have wallpaper, it had to be hand printed. Now it can be printed somewhere and shipped to you, and it's done in an automatic format. Clothes are mass produced. food is mass produced, and we see furniture mass produced, pianos are mass produced. This allows items to be made quicker, cheaper, and more readily available. It also provides many new jobs for many new people, which means that the rural poor start to move into the city areas so that they can be part of this new expansion. That means we see a massive development when it comes to urban sprawl and suburban sprawl throughout Europe and America. Women enter the workforce. Women work in textile mills. In fact, Lowell, Massachusetts, it's one of the earliest spots in this country for women to be involved in industry on a massive scale. There were women factory owners and factory head individuals in Lowell throughout the 19th century. Child labor, unfortunately, as well, but we have child labor laws that are established in the early 20th century that help us with that. And when you have this rise of this new middle class, which is feeding off of this industrial revolution, you have this new class of people that are able to afford things for the first time that they were never able to afford before, and they want a taste of the good life. They want their cute little town home in England, and they want to go ahead and furnish it the way they've seen the wealthy people do based on the little drawings they see in magazines. And so they start to do things to imitate the wealthy, just as we do today. If you look at so many aspects of our lives that are imitating better quality, how many of us have seen faux granite countertops? Because we have to imitate the better, but we don't want to pay for it. So it's the same basic concept. And music comes into the play of this because music now can be in the home. And it can also be out in a performance. Here's what ends up happening. Music gets smaller because people can now pay people to come in and sit in their front living room, and they can now play. We have the salon style instruments. We have salon style performances. We have people who specialize as performers in going from home to home to home, and they don't really have large voices or large performance practices, but they work well in a living room. And so friends can gather, and after a nice dinner, they can listen to a person performing. Also, you have the piano. It's affordable. It's factory made. You can now own it in your own home. And now you can take music right into your own house for the first time in history whenever you want to. And it's not even that hard to play. And there are plenty of people around who will teach you for relatively cheap. Music as a concert. So music as a concert, meaning that now you can pay to go see the people that only the wealthy had access to. You can pay to purchase a ticket because now you have money to do more than just buy food. You have expendable money. And now you can afford a ticket to see a famous composer's work for the first time. If you can imagine what it must have been like to hear a symphony for the very first time, it must have been mind-blowing for these people who had no access to any kind of recording, and to know that the wealthy had been living this way for generations. It was a huge breakthrough. We've never seen that before. We have seen it since. If we want to think about the last 20 years and the internet age, this is a whole new world for us, and how many millionaires have been made, and how many young people graduating with a degree in computer science are now littering California and driving up the real estate prices. So we do have the same thing again, where we have this rise of this new class of tech-savvy individuals who can handle this. Definitely a little bit of a salute to Mark, to Russ there, who can understand all this stuff, because I don't. Okay, so the working class taste becomes gentrified. What's happening there is we get this taste of the folk songs and the things that they once loved back when they were rural, back when they were working class, and they gentrify it. They make it a bit fancier. We see composers such as Beethoven using these folk dances and this kind of pastoral vibe to it to really kind of bring out this vibe to some extent, and they love it. They eat it up. They also like the fantastic because they like things that are a bit bigger and more glam. Same as we see today, sometimes people just can't hold their bling. We have people that just, they haven't had money for too long, they're nouveau riche, and boom, it's all over the place bling, and it's the Kardashians. And that's exactly what's happening here. We're just getting a bit too fantastic, which they definitely do. So we've got a lot happening in this time frame, and that's just on a scale that's not even affiliated that much with sacred. Sacred music's moving all over the place too. That all being said, next slide. So this is something that I put together actually for my my eighth graders when they were in virtual last year. I want to explain to them in a visual guide how the classes work. These are three cabins, replica cabins from the Titanic. And yes, it's 22 years after the Romantic era ended. However, at the same time, it really does show for us exactly the difference between the classes. We look first at the first class. It's comfortable. It's large, but it's also showing off its wealth. Wood paneling, dark colors. You have a lot of fabric. You have a lot of ornate work. Now take a look at the middle picture, middle class. Look at the ornate work that you, the woodwork that you see. They're trying to emulate the style that they would see in the picture to the left. You have the same wood paneling. At the same time, you also have a bed with a little bit of extra furnishings on it. You have a little curtain to the side. You have a writing table. You have above it, though, a wallpaper. They're not going to put that wood paneling all the way up, but they will put it halfway up. It's not as fancy, but it still has that same look. And then you have the lower class, the third class. At that point, it's just bare bones, basic. There's nothing fancy. Look at the walls. They're plain. They're bare. There's nothing to make it feel pleasing. It's simply there and present. And that's exactly how the three classes develop out throughout the Romantic era. And it's the middle class trying to emulate the upper class, which ends up creating so much change within this era. Let's go on to the next slide. We're going to talk about humanitarian characteristics in music. Humanitarian meaning how aspects of all of the other things affecting it are coming in and enclosing upon music and making music be bended and twisted in whole new directions. First off, we have complexity of chords and rhythms that we didn't see before. We start seeing music becoming even more vertical than we've ever talked about. Chords get larger, thicker. People start pressing in on that tonality. What's pleasant to the ear? How far can I push it? How far can I push contrast? At what point does the ear say it's too much? I don't want this anymore. And what can I do to create even more intense releases? After all, with a more intense contrast, will I have a more intense release on this? How do I make this structure work? And we start to see composers really playing with this. Emotional expression. Composers become obsessed with expressing things emotionally, trying to word paint, trying to create whole images, and it's not even word painting. We have one indication in the Romeo and Juliet choral symphony by Berlioz, where it's describing a love scene, and at a certain point the Juliet theme is actually played outside of the Romeo theme. It's actually inside the Juliet theme, and it doesn't take too much to think that Berlioz probably planned that and probably had some ideas. We see incredible detail. It's absolutely mind-boggling the amount of musical theory that they had to understand in order to create these pieces. We see themes, different kinds of themes. Norse mythology, European mythology in general, we see a return to ideas of the Gothic and the medieval, but they're romanticized. They are now in a different thought process. Now we see the damsel in distress. Now we get the iron cage as a torture device, which, by the way, never existed in medieval life. Now we see several other items that never existed in medieval life, but it sure looks great in a painting. Here's where our fiery dragons really start to come in. Yes, they were there in hagiography, but they really start getting painted in the 19th century. Chromaticism. And chromaticism is fun to try and explain to non-music individuals. But chromaticism basically means I am stair-stepping my way down or up on sounds, and normally those would be too close together and they'd have a bit of an itchy feel to us. But here we like it. It takes longer to resolve, and sometimes it doesn't even resolve all the way at all. We start seeing excess. We start seeing things get really big and really over the top. Berlioz is making these massive things. Berlioz writes a story. Berlioz decides to murder the love of his life in his dream, and then he decides to then he has himself executed, and then he writes a symphony about it because, you know, he's Berlioz. And of course, as we all know, you can hear the axe coming down. We're going to push our ears as far as we can, and we're going to try it all in the name of intense beauty, because even intensity in its most uncomfortable moment is beauty. And we're going to be influenced by everything, by Charles Darwin and evolution. We're going to be influenced by the rise of atheism and the contrasting with the spiritual world. We're going to be influenced by Goethe and his poems. We're going to be influenced by ballet and the rise of the first major ballet with Giselle in the mid 19th century. Huge affects all over the place. The painters rising up out of the time as well. So with all that happening, music is going to be over the top and crazy no matter what genre you're in. Let's move on to the next slide and test that out. Let's take a look at a Mozart and then compare it to a Berlioz. So Mozart's Lacrimosa from his Requiem, starting first. The very end of the classical. Now let's see what Berlioz is doing in the romantic. It's jarring, it's passionate, it's complex. It's not Mozart. Let's move on to the next slide. The next slide we have is going to compare us again, once again, to two different pieces of music from the two different time frames. First off, we have the Coronation Mass. So we're looking back into the classical, and it's a Kyrie. I'm going to compare that to Beethoven's Mass in C, also a Kyrie. It's not as crazy as Berlioz, and it lets us hear how Beethoven is able to create a lush warmth that you're not going to hear in the classical era. You will hear with Beethoven. You can still make warmth and beauty and not go as crazy as Berlioz. Let's start with the Coronation, though. Let's go and take a look at the Beethoven now and get a little bit of a different sound, not as crazy as Berlioz, but a bit warmer than Mozart. Thank you. So we can hear there's quite a difference between the two of them. And these pieces are written at this point about 30 years apart from each other. That's a huge difference in sound. It's very lush, it's very warm. So let's move on to the next slide so we can talk about two final concepts before we... Katy. Lower, and it never... Oh, did I lose you? Did I go out?
You're back now. Okay.
Okay, back. Okay, so Chopin. Listen to the Chopin, and what ends up happening is the with the Chopin, you can hear in the left sounds, the lower sounds. Listen for those. They will stair-step downwards, but they'll never actually feel like they're resolving. It'll never feel like it's complete. That's chromaticism. Let's go ahead and take a listen. Frozen. Got you back?
Yep. Hello.
Okay. Cool. So let's move on to the Ave Maria Stella, which is a list. This will give us a chance to see how that works a bit when it comes to the choral voices. But what's cool about this one is that list actually incorporates some of the old chant in the very beginning of it, a very chant-like line. So let's take a listen. So now we have the music of the music of the church in a performance place, really. It's been there since classical, but it's really starting to kick in now as a performance, a real art form. What's magical about Liszt, though, is that Liszt, as we'll learn in a little bit, is writing it not so much as a composer, but as a priest at this point. And it's really quite amazing how he manages to combine those two and is really showing a sense of true passion for what he believes. Next slide, please. Salon and chamber music. So this is suitable for small spaces such as living rooms. It often features a soloist of some kind, You would have vocalists or piano, strings. It's composed specifically for this setting. It fits very well. A good composer for this, who unfortunately is not mentioned tonight, is Schubert, who is one of my all-time favorites, and I'm very sorry to be leaving him out. And it's enjoyed by both the wealthy and the middle classes. I just love this warmth of this painting. The pianist is there. Everybody's admiring him, relaxing after a lovely dinner of some kind. It just looked like this most beautiful warmth, and it looks like how we always imagine those beautiful Jane Austen moments to look. So let's move on from that, though, to the next slide, to the concert hall, the Royal Albert Hall. Incredible amount of space. We're seeing this at the end of the 19th century, and you see these lovely spaces, this one being one of the definitely one of the largest, that are cropping up at this point, because the middle class can afford a ticket and they can afford to have that expendable money and to see musicians, which means that composers can then at this point be focused more on working on what the middle class might want to hear versus working with a specific patron. And in these spaces, you get large sacred works, like Berlioz's Requiem, large sacred works that are not supposed to be merely spiritual, although his has spiritual connotations, but it's more of an in memoriam, and the text happens to be sacred, and that's simply an afterthought. Let's go on to the next slide, where we have an example of yet another large work. This one needs no introduction. I'll talk about it in a moment. One of the few pieces that makes me very happy to be an alto. It's a more fun line. Now, when it comes to these massive pieces, Verdi is writing this. This is Giuseppe Verdi. This is an Italian piece. And this is one of our opera requiems, where we have opera structure, opera arias that are being configured into the requiem. So the requiem has moved as far away as it possibly can from a traditional sacred setting. And now it is truly in the realm of performance art. It has moved quite beyond. Let us move on to the next slide to see what Brahms does with sacred work. Let's take a listen first. Because I realized that in my copying and pasting, I put up the wrong video. Although I absolutely love that one, that one's not sacred. But what that one does show, that I will use this for instead, is it shows the use of earlier formats, the Romantic format, calling back to the Renaissance. At that point, he's hearkening back to the Renaissance with that lovely rhythmic mode, that dun, 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 that beautiful rhythmic mode-esque pattern that he's using. Brahms early in his life was very focused on creating that earlier sound, and this is a good example. Also, it provides me with one other point to talk about, and that is, yes, there were professional choirs at this point, and this is for Frauenchor. This is for a women's group that Brahms actually directed in Germany. So we were seeing women that got together and did rehearsals and had performances. Isn't that a lovely thing that we miss now? So these do happen. In fact, the picture to the left is actually a male choir at the Musikverein in Vienna. So yes, we do still have the concept of choir happening, and now it's happening in a more concert-esque space. So let's move on to the next slide. The patron system, it's about to be exterminated. And orchestral expansion. Next slide, please. So let's talk about this one. So basically what we need to know is, at this point, I told you several weeks ago that the patron system was a wonderful thing and it wasn't going to be too long before I told you that it was no longer a good thing. We're there. We're officially there. So the trouble with the patron system is, of course, you have to do exactly what they tell you to do. If somebody wealthy says, please make me a piece that does this, 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 and this, and it's for this thing, then you have to do it because that's how it works. When it comes to the middle class and its rise and the interest in the concert halls, we have a new system going on now. Now the composer can write what they want based on what's going to sell to the general public. And if they're popular, then they can set the trend. Now they can be the one to kind of move music forward as they wish to move it forward. It's not so much about what the patron wants. It's about what the general public is willing to pay for. And if the general public likes you, they're willing to trust you and to take it in the direction that you are going in. So we see the patron system start to fall. That doesn't mean that they're not still working for people who can pay them. We still do this today. Commissions happen all the time, but they're independent. It's no longer where you work under somebody, you're contracted to them, you belong to them, you're monoverity, you haven't been paid in 2 years, you're actually starving to death, and your wife has died, and it's really bad. That was what he was going through. Beethoven is a very different person for that. So let's talk about the major composers in this game. First off, Beethoven. Second, Brahms. Third, Mendelssohn. Fourth, Liszt. Fifth, Berlioz. Sixth, Verdi. And I went ahead and put on Fanny Mendelssohn and Clara Schumann because I had to be able to bring up a female composer finally for our audience. They needed to be able to hear that a female composer is happening and they're wonderful. And the only reason why they're not bigger on the list is because they had famous guys that they were related to. And it wasn't considered womanly yet to do this, but they were fantastic at what they did. And I truly recommend going on YouTube, listening to their music. It's amazing. Between the two of them, I'm a bigger fan of Fanny Mendelssohn, I'll just be honest. But I do love Clara Schumann's work as well. Beethoven is the one who breaks the mold, and he really straddles two periods. He's classical in the beginning of his life, and he crosses over to romantic. All of my students seem to think that he was deaf his whole life. So in case you're of that same thought process, no, he lost most of his hearing later in life. He was not deaf from birth. And it's a situation that sadly we could actually correct relatively easy now. It wasn't that difficult of a medical situation, we assume. So once he started to go deaf, he began to press tonality a bit further than he had already been pressing it, but he was already pushing the boundary of what was acceptable earlier on. So let's move on to Johannes Brahms. Brahms lives in Beethoven's shadow. Beethoven is the superstar. He's the genius of music at this time. Brahms is constantly comparing himself to Beethoven and is constantly thinking that he's not doing enough. He has complete imposter syndrome. And he writes about this all the time. Clara Schumann is frequently trying to convince him that what he's doing is good enough. But what he does produce of the many, many incredible pieces of music is the German Requiem, Ein Deutsches Requiem, which is, in my opinion, one of the most fantastic pieces of music of all time. Although it's not Catholic, it uses the term, it uses some idea of it, it uses none of the structure, and it's absolutely brilliant, and we'll go into it in a minute. Mendelssohn, who is Jewish, wrote an oratorio. It's Elijah. He's one of the first in the several generations to do that. That was a Baroque thing. You know, he's really hearkening back to some, he's very vintage. But he also rediscovers Bach and puts Bach back on the map. But we wouldn't have Bach today if it wasn't for Mendelssohn. Liszt is this virtuosic rock star, the first of the Beatles, the ones where women were throwing their pantaloons up on the stage. Well, it was a bit different back then, but that's the basic idea. And he retires from that life at a certain point and becomes a priest. and changes his entire thought process. The man lived life to the fullest in every possible way. And then we have Berlioz, this amazing eccentric who just embodies romanticism and drug use during this time frame. He was a complete opium addict, and that's probably the reason why he wrote what he wrote. But at the same time, that music is just so encapsulative of all of the ideas that romanticism stands for. Verdi is our opera king and guru, and also political statement maker. But let's now focus on a couple of these, because there's just too many to spend time with. So let's move on to the next slide and spend a bit of time with Beethoven. Okay, Beethoven, I've got two sets for you. Let's go ahead and go to the first one. You might almost be excused to think of that as almost classical sounding. It's so early in his career. It has a very classical sound to it. Not so much later. We'll know very quickly. If you looked at that gentleman, Donald Newman, and you thought to yourself, wow, those gestures and that haircut and all that look very familiar to those of us who have experience with the University of Arizona. Yes, he did also study at the same school as Bruce Chamberlain. So I'm thinking the haircut might have come with it. So let's move on to the next one. It is the third period, and this is Beethoven dipping into a bit more chromaticism. Next slide. We missed one. There you go. Johannes Brahms, Requiem. Ein Deutsches Requiem takes the concept of the Mass for the Dead, the Requiem Mass, and he alters it. None of the movements come from the ordinary or the proper. None of the movements are Catholic. They are simply an in memoriam. He uses the term Requiem, but it is meant to be simply a use of biblical text. But most importantly, this piece of music is the one Requiem Mass that is not written for the dead. It is written for the living. Blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. It's from the Beatitudes. He also uses text that comes to us from Revelation for the end. There are seven movements. They mirror each other. The outer two, the first and the seven, are pretty much the same. Then you see six and two. Then you see three, and then you see five, and four stands alone because four was actually not part of the original composition. It was added in later. But the entire structure of the piece is to create a sense of peace, understanding of emotion of somebody who is mourning loss, who's mourning death, and that sense of peace that they are in a place that is better, a place of life everlasting. As hard as it was to pick a movement, I'm going with the seventh movement for this one. So just a few quick moments of that one, Russ. Let's go ahead and shorten the time. Let's go ahead and stop it right there, Russ. Thank you. Next slide, please. I would love to show you the example of this one. I already showed you one example, so I'm thinking I'm going to have to cut List as my person for tonight. We still have quite a bit to cover in American Hymnody, and I'm going to have to rush it a bit. So I do want to note, though, because he has this incredible life, his shift to holy orders after a life of such rock starness is really quite amazing. And his pieces afterwards just ooze devotion. There is nothing about him that is insincere. And if you listen to his piece of music, they're worthy of weeping over. There's so much passion for Christ, so much passion for his faith, for the Catholic Church as a whole. I strongly recommend look at his sacred choral works. They are truly fantastic works. So we're going to skip over the next slide, and we're going to really quickly take a look at the changes in the orchestra. This is what the orchestra looked like as of Romantic. And it's pretty similar to what it's looking like today. Our major changes have been made. Let's go to the next slide for a list. Okay, so on the left, we have everything that's in the classical orchestra. On the right, we have everything that the Romantic orchestra adds. And they also add multiple extra instruments from the classical side too. It might now be three horns, three trumpets, three flutes, not just one. Things are getting much, much, much bigger. Please note, I've put the saxophone on there. Saxophone is a 19th century woodwind instrument that was originally developed to be part of orchestras and sadly was the victim of a business scheme that failed. Otherwise, it would be. It was blacklisted as an instrument and later picked up by jazz musicians because it was cheap and because it's incredibly versatile. So it was originally going to be one of our woodwinds, and yet now we are blessed with it in jazz music instead. So think about that the next time you listen to a saxophone, but take a look at that incredible list of extra things that we're adding in the Romantics, how we must add things and be very dramatic during this time. Let's move on to the next slide. Of course, the most quintessential instrument is this one, which we won't need to do a video for. It's there, but we don't need to do it as a video. And that is, of course, the piano. It is flexible, movable. It can be installed in homes and churches. It's a fraction of a cost of an organ. It can be manufactured in these new factories. It can express the aesthetic criteria of the music of the day. It's absolutely perfect in every way. I'm sure Russ agrees with me. Let's move on to the next slide.
Oh yeah. Big fan.
Part three, America and the hymnal. We are back on our continent again. And let's move on to the next slide. What's happening? So singing schools in America are these places where basically children are being taught to learn music. They're taught by paid traveling educators who come They usually stay with one or two family members throughout the time that they're there. They stay for maybe a few months. They teach the children how to sing in the church settings, and then they move on to the next place. These singing schools were found to be incredibly effective when it comes to teaching sight reading, and their concepts and their ideas were then incorporated by Lowell Mason, who is the father of music education in America, into the Boston public schools in the 1830s and 40s. So we can thank these early church hymns singing schools for the fact that we have music education in public schools. Now, when we are looking at these hymns, we are referring to four-part hymns. These are happening both in Catholic and in Protestant settings at the same time. And in addition, we're also going to chat real quickly about shape note singing. I'll be honest, it's my favorite topic ever besides medieval. So I can go off for a long time if I want to on shape note. But shape note singing is a really brilliant idea that allows people who have less education to be able to read music faster and to be able to read more complex music quicker. So we will take a look at shape note singing as well. Let's move on to the next slide. First off, the mission schools. I'm not going to leave them hanging. Last week, they were with us, and I want to make sure we talk about them. So we still don't have a lot of information about the Arizona missions. I'm really disappointed. Have not heard back yet from St. Xavier, but I did find a lovely documentary on the next page. And for this one, though, I want to let us know what I have found from California. There are roughly 20 choir books from the 21 active California missions that used music throughout the California region during the Golden Age, which was 1790 to 1830. Some say 1780 to 1830, but 90 seemed the most one. First off, they used mensural or Renaissance notation, an older form of notation. They were not using our modern notation. Second, they have choirs with as many as 40 people. They did have discrete orchestras, but it was frowned upon, but they did use it. And we heard last week as Juan Baptista Sancho actually composed for orchestras. They also used local traditional instruments, local native instruments, drums, especially from the native cultures. They would use them in the mass services as well. And they used choirs of both mixed men and women. If you're interested in more information, that YouTube link links you to a really great documentary about 7 minutes long on music in the California missions that adds on to what I've already told you. That way you can hear a bit of it as well. So let's move on to the next slide. This is San Xavier in 1940. It's so cool to see it.
No story of our Southwest is complete without reference to the missions built in the early days to bring civilization and Christianity to pagan Indian tribes. One of the more colorful of these missions is San Xavier del Buc, an oasis of architectural delight located on the desert line 9 miles south of Tucson, Arizona. For more than a century and a half, this church has been a shrine for the Indians, descendants of the early native tribesmen who helped build it. The first mission here, built by a famous Jesuit priest, fell into ruins, was later restored and rebuilt by the Franciscans. Many of you have probably heard about that Jesuit priest who brought the teachings of Christ to the Southwest over 300 years ago. San Xavier del Buc is a memorial to the good works and good deeds of that pioneer missionary. He journeyed more than 20,000 miles by donkey or by foot over a period of 24 years. He established missions and converted 50,000 Indians to Christianity. From his base in Mexico, he pushed into the desert wilderness that is now Arizona, spreading the gospel of the Lord. As the communities prospered, missions would be established with priest and native working side by side, building a house of worship where God's will was done. The descendants of those early workmen worship and play amid inspiring surroundings, picked out by a desert missionary who lived so long ago. His name is a household word to these happy children who learn in their history books how the King of Spain banished him and his fellow Jesuits despite the great work they had done. Now here is our question. What was the name of that great Jesuit priest? You have 5 seconds by the clock. Father Aquino was his name. But stand by now for more interesting places to go.
I was absolutely thrilled to find that thing. God bless YouTube. I couldn't believe it. It was great to see what it was like back then. So unfortunately, I'm going to leave missions behind for a little bit, but let's go back to the other side of the country to Sacred Harp. Next slide, please. shape note singing. This is the Sacred Harp hymnal. It's the name of the hymnal. And when people say Sacred Harp, they're usually referring to simply shape note singing. So let's go ahead and go through some basics. Shape note singing is a visual device made to assist in the learning of musical sight reading in early American singing schools. The notation we see today was introduced between 1795 and 1801. The notation is on the bottom on the other side of the screen, the C major scale. You see the different shapes. This notation system uses a combination of Guido Solfeggio with notes in four different shapes on the staff. You have triangle, square, oval, and diamond. And it's sung in a square formation of the congregation. Each part, each voice part sings on one side, soprano, alto, tenor, or death count. And the singers will sing through the solfege first, and then they will sing through the actual text. They'll actually sing all of the solfege on the hymn first. The middle voice, by the way, carries the melody, not the upper voices. If we hearken all the way back to the Middle Ages, there you go, right down the middle, instead of being on the top. Now, they do fugues and counterpoint and odd voice leadings, and yet they're able to do it because the shape note singing with the limited number of solfege names helps people learn it a bit faster. It tends to have a lot of open fifths and fourths and unisons. It has a very ancient sound to it. We really affiliate it with ancient or older Americana. And the Sacred Harp hymnal, as we know it today, was compiled in 1844. People still use it all over the world in Sacred Harp conventions. P.S. We have one Sacred Harp convention right here in Tucson. They are currently closed for COVID, but they do exist second Saturday of every month. They're SOLA, and they are here. So let's move on to the next page, and let's go ahead and take a look at what this stuff sounds like.
186.
186.
186.
I'll sing the words.
No, no, sorry, Russ. Keep going, keep going.
So what you have there, this is keeping the tempo, this is keeping the beat. And the idea is it's not supposed to sound pretty. It's supposed to be for God. It doesn't matter. It's supposed to be joyful. And if it sounds absolutely terrible, that's totally okay. Going down one slide, I just want to show you real quickly that this stuff is still alive and exists. It's not just for old generations. This was done this year.
Oh,
So that, by the way, is in County Cork in Ireland. It's our music. It's made it to Ireland. They borrowed from us. We've been borrowing for Europe for generations, and now they're borrowing from us. So I'm actually thinking that right now might be a good place to let it go. My hymnals can wait until next week. I think I may start us off next week with an introduction to how these hymn tunes can be flipped from book to book throughout the denominations of Protestantism, and also here into a Catholic book as well, which is what this one is. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make this introduction to hymnal slide will be the first slide of my next lecture as well. That way we can go straight into the hymn reform and the Cecilian movement and how that pertains to the book and how the book is laid out. But in the meantime, let's go on to the next slide, because we will not see each other next week. And that is why, for those of you, of course, who are gobble gobblers, as I tell all of my kids, I wish you a happy turkey day or a happy tofu day, whatever makes you happier. So next week, we're going to move into the 20th century. We prepare ourselves for yet another reckoning within the church, because we are going to prepare ourselves for the times right before Vatican II. We're going to go right up to the 1960s. We won't actually hit Vatican II, but we're going to go ahead and just butt right up to it, which means, to tell you the truth, this might actually be a really great place to get started so we can see where that feels. But I do also want to spend some time talking about the French Catholic composers like Fauré and Durufle and Saint-Saëns, and the amazing work that they did creating these incredible, lush, devout pieces of music that also harken back to some very, very old chant practices. So bring your listening ears. Next week should be a lot of fun. And if you happen to have a hymnal, pull it out. We'll have fun taking a look and seeing how these things work, because you can actually play around with these and have a lot of fun. Who's got some questions for me in this wonderful garble mess?
Well, I don't have a question, but I have to say that whole Sacred Harp stuff, like, I had no idea. Never heard of it. I was like, I tell you, I was the world's worst music major. I didn't know that was even a thing.
It's like the coolest thing. Like, the first time I heard it was actually as a music major in undergrad. It hit me like a wall. I'm like, what is this stuff? And I was raised a fundamentalist evangelical, and I still had never heard of it. And it's now primarily in primitive Baptist churches throughout the Deep South. So I should have known it growing up, but I didn't.
Yeah,
but
no, that was fascinating.
Cool. Yeah.
All of it is fascinating to me, but that in particular, I'm like, how did I miss this?
I'm glad you like it.
Yeah.
Vicky, did you have anything for me tonight? She's getting carpal tunnel scribbling away tonight.
Gotta unmute, Vicky. I can't do it from here. Vicky, unmute, please.
Oh, yeah, I've got a choral and praise that I couldn't tell you which state I was in.
Ah, I got one too.
Oh, cool, yay!
Well, praise, buddies.
So many states. And then I have Gather Comprehensive.
Yes, nice.
I've got, I don't know how many I've got here.
I like Gather. Gather's great.
Yeah, they don't, that was in New York. We use that one in New York.
Okay.
At the time.
I have to admit, I love any hymnal, but I literally have everything from Journey Song all the way to the Unitarian Universalist hymnal. I've literally everything in between. Hymnals are amazing, and there are so many tunes that are actually in every single one. That was one I wanted to talk about tonight, is a tune that makes its way into literally every single book, and we'll talk about it next week so we can see. And it's really cool because it's so moldable that anybody's text can fit on it like a puzzle. It's really neat.
Yeah, this is nice. We're learning a lot.
It's a lot. To this week was a rough one. I told Russ before we got started, I'm like, oh, I could go on for like 5 hours on this century. There's just so much to cover. They did so much during this time, but at the same time, you know, we want to keep it short, keep it focused. So next week we will get into those first 60 years or so prior to all the big changes. And then the following week. And then the week after that, we will get into 1962 to the present, which again, that's gonna be me just going as fast as I can, trying to get through so much stuff. But
changed from the 60s.
Yes. A lot, sure. 70s,
you know, and now.
Absolutely. It's going to be, it'll be a bit of a rushed lecture, but we'll get a good taste as we go through of everything. So if nobody has any questions, then I'll say good night.
Have a good Thanksgiving.
You too. You too. And thank you for coming, Gina.
Thank you, Katy. Illuminating as always.
And Russ, thank you for all your hard work. You're amazing.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
All right. I'll talk to you later.
All right.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.